We really should wrap this up and we'll begin our service. Let's go ahead and turn back to the Acts chapter number 13. Acts chapter number 13 this morning. We're actually going back because you know, we're all quite a bit further, about 10 chapters ahead in our regular preaching. But this morning, the Lord laid upon this passage upon my heart as I've been preparing. You know, this last week, Dana Carvey's son died. Dex Carvey died of a drug overdose, and I got mixed feelings about this because some of you know Dana Carvey. How many of you know Dana Carvey? From the 1980s, he was on Saturday Night Live, and as I read all the many comments, they were talking about how, you know, so sad for his family and everything else. I says, you know, this guy in his youth was on Saturday Night Live, and he made his bones making fun of Christianity in the church. I read an article 10, 12 years ago about it because he had made millions and launched his career on Saturday Night Live as a cross-dresser, as a dressing as the church lady. You remember that? And he was sassy, and the church lady would take benign things, regular things, and turn them into something ugly. And he made fun of church and propagated a stereotype of church. And he was the Sunday school teacher. And he go, well, isn't that special? And some of you remember that anything anybody ever said, he'd turn it around and say, well, who could it be? Who could it be? And of course, Cindy, who was it? And he would say, say? And he would make fun of the church lady. Made fun of Christianity. I read an article about it. He was raised in church. And decided he'd make his bones that way. And he made millions making fun of church people and the church lady. And I thought about it because before I went to church, I watched it and thought, oh man, those church people, they're like this. I thought that's the way church, everybody, Satan. It helped color my view of church when all I had was Catholicism. I went to Catholic school and I knew a little bit about Catholic church because I went there. But I didn't know anything about an evangelical church, Bible-believing church, and he colored my view. And I thought about how many people were shaded against Christianity because he kind of put a negative taste in their mouth, something that simply wasn't true, but he made millions doing it. It was fun, and I thought to myself as I learned of his son's drug overdose from a heroin overdose, I thought maybe he could have used a few more church ladies in his life growing up. The restrictions of the Bible weren't put on this kid, and now here he is. And the verse came back to my mind, God is not mocked. Whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. And I wondered, would he trade all those millions of dollars, turn around and change his life and not do those things and not mock God if he could have his son back? How much would you pay? How much would you give up to have someone you loved back? We often want to see God work in immediate ways, and sometimes he does. When we see sinners and people mocking him or cruelly taking out his children, we see Christians being persecuted and in their patience, hanging in there. When you see these terrorists in the Middle East taking young men who had converted to Christ and left Islam, left the religion of the Mohammedans. And you see the pictures where these young men refuse to recant the faith of Jesus Christ. And these young ISIS warriors cutting off their heads, putting them at the feet of a cross as they hang their bodies on a cross, cut their heads and put them at their feet in a public square to say, this is what happens to Christians. To Muslims who convert and become Christians. Have you seen the pictures? I've seen them. And the evil that people do, you wonder, does it come back to them? Sometimes it's not right away, sometimes it is right away. Nobody escapes life without justice. There is a providential God who sees everything. And though it may appear in this life that a sinner is able to escape retribution. At times, karma appears to fail. But there is no karma. There is God. And we have a God who is alive. He is real. He sees all things. And it is incumbent upon us not to mistake His patience for apathy or absence. Let's look at Acts chapter number 13. We'll begin in verse number 4 because the young missionary group, Paul and Barnabas, are sent out from the local church. They're in Antioch. And they're on their first mission, and the Bible says, "So they being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia. And from thence they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. And they had also John to their minister. And when they had gone through the Isle of Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. But Elymaeus, the sorcerer, for so his name by it, so is his name by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Then Saul, who also is called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, O full of subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness. And he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord." May God bless the reading and hearing of His Word. Father, in the few moments we have this morning, I pray that You would take the bread of life and feed the many hungry souls that have come this morning. For we are thankful. We are thankful, Father, for we serve a living God and not a dead religion of rules, do's and don'ts. But Heavenly Father, we serve a living God who is active and real. And this mission in this world, Father, is Yours first and foremost. Heavenly Father, thank You for calling us to Yourselves. Give us light and understanding this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This sorcerer was a local. He was a local man. He was a local prophet. He was someone who had control and sway over the people. He was not someone who is in cahoots with Paul and Barnabas or the Christian gospel. And he made it pretty plain that he was going to be the enemy of the gospel. He was actively trying to undermine what God was doing there in that first century. At the very beginning of this ministry, Satan was trying to stop the gospel, and it was the beginning of resistance for Paul and Barnabas in this new ministry. Of course, Paul knew there was going to be a resistance. He had been part of the resistance. He himself had been converted from opposing the gospel of Jesus Christ. That which he had destroyed or previously destroyed, he was now preaching and propagating. He knew the power and the motivations of the people behind it. But here on this island, what was this man's motivation? It is not that he was a classical Jew. He was Jewish, but he was a man that had blended the religion with sorcery. He himself had a great deal of sway. This is a time period where people would take that which was mystical, mix it with philosophy, mix it with the spiritual, and then mix it with pharmaceuticals. When you see the sorcerers of the first century, they often mix drugs with the experience of spirituality. And of course, nothing has really changed, whether you're in Africa or in India or in China or the New World, of course, Old World Europe. Looking for spiritual experiences through drugs has been the story as long as the world has been around. Of course, in the 1960s, you had that revolution, right? Timothy O'Leary, drop in, drop out. Drop acid. And using various pharmacological hallucinogens to be able to break on through to the other side, as the Doors sang. They're all looking for something, but they were looking for something in the wrong place. They were looking for God in experiences where they were trying to force that experience, trying to force that hand by using pharmacologicals, by using drugs, trying to find God. And that's just not how you find God. Those pharmacologicals perhaps loosen your mind's red flags. Perhaps it allows you to, by faith, gain access to a spiritual world, but you will not find God there. You'll find spirituality, but you won't find God. In these modern days, there are a lot of psychologists who are beginning to mix this concept of pharmacology with spirituality. And of course, for people who have cancer and certain diseases which are terminal and are very afraid of dying, they have begun to use various doses in a clinical setting of hallucinogens to try to give people a spiritual experience, to allow them to open their mind a little bit and experience something so powerful through a hallucinogen that it perhaps gives them a view that perhaps this is not all that there is and that there is more, and not to be afraid of that which is spiritual. But I tell you, you are right to be afraid of death if you have in your heart the uncertainty that your sins will catch up with you. That the decisions of your life will catch up with you. And if you have not truly gotten peace with God, taking a drug and having an experience that may be light and wonderful and mind-expanding will give you a false sense of security. And from the very beginning of time, Satan's one edge and advantage is to trick people into a false sense of security. We spoke a little bit about Adam and Eve this morning in the Sunday school message. You're going to want to go back and watch that on the YouTube channel later if you missed it. The devil said, hath God said, don't eat of the fruit? You know that this fruit is wonderful. God is just trying to keep you from experiences. He's trying to keep you from something. He knows that it's wonderful, it's good, it's pleasing to the eyes and satisfying to the taste and to the appetite. God knows that if you eat the fruit, that you'll become like Him. Don't you want to be like Him? We're already made in His image. And in this, when we sin, we know evil. But the devil gave him a false sense of security that, hey, if you do this, if you yield to this temptation, it's going to be okay. You're going to be okay. It is how he always applies things to us. The devil is against God. He always wants to make you comfortable, believing that it's going to be okay in your sin, that there is some other way. And a lot of people who are facing their eternity, who are turning to psychologists and drugs to find some kind of peace, some kind of experience, some kind of opportunity to break through to the other side and get a little taste of what awaits them on the other side. And they talk about after their experience that they have so much more peace, knowing that there is something on that other side. But it is not what they think it is. What's waiting for them is not what their drug experience has shown them. It is a false sense of security. Oh, the devil will always give you that. Not always is it drugs, but Elias, this sorcerer, he used drugs to fool people, to get them under their power, to give them a false sense of security, and to build himself up. But there are a lot of folks who will simply tell you or let people believe that if you're a basically good person, you'll go to heaven. There are no basically good people in heaven. The Bible said we all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Each and every human, once you reach the age of accountability, once you know the difference between right or wrong, it's not long before you choose wrong. We're corrupted by a sinful nature, and we soon cross that threshold. We soon bite the apple that had been forbidden. But we feel like, hey, we're in good company. Look how many others. God couldn't possibly condemn everybody, could he? Well, God condemns sin. God condemns sin, and if everybody sins, certainly he could. I think the testimony of the great flood and the idea of Noah being saved by faith, but God willing to destroy the entire civilization, should put it in perspective that God is holy and that he has lines that cannot be crossed, that sin must be dealt with, it must be paid for. It cannot be brushed under the rug. It is not forgotten without being satisfied. Justice cries out in his ears. Because God is just, he cannot ignore it. He said, but it happened so long ago. Well, we sin every single day, don't we? It's often minutes ago. But when we think of sin, sometimes we think of big sins. We think of major sins. We think of some things that perhaps are even crimes. There are a lot of spiritual crimes with God that are perfectly legal in the civil court. Increasingly so in this day as we loosen pretty much restrictions on almost all personal behavior, it seems. That almost nothing is illegal concerning personal outlets and indulgences in our modern day. But these things are still crimes with God. There are thoughts that are crimes. In fact, God is probably the only one can properly convict us of a thought crime. Because there's nothing that's not naked and open to him. He sees everything. He knows your heart. He knows your intentions. He even knows you better than you know yourself. He knows why you do what you do when you don't know what you do. Or why you do what you do. But the devil will whisper in your ear, it's okay. You're not as bad as this person. You're not as bad as your brother. At least you're not as bad as your father. And praise God, if you're not, that's a good thing, but it doesn't get us in scopability because when God looks at our lives, he's not going to judge you compared to these people who are perhaps doing something a little bit worse. No, all sin, the Bible says, is a crime against God, and God will judge us appropriately, but in Romans chapter 3, it says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So if God sets a standard and it's pretty high and we all fall short of it, that means we all lose. If God put a basketball goal up that was 10 feet high, most of us can't dunk a basketball anymore, right? He says, if you want to get into heaven, you need to drive to the hoop and jump and dive and slam that basketball. If you can slam the basketball, he said, doesn't matter, two hands, one hand. If you can slam that basketball in a 10-foot goal, I'll let you into heaven. Well, there'd be a limited number of people on earth that could go to heaven. I've been to Guatemala. Nobody in that country would go to heaven. My wife is from Guatemala. Oh, my wife, who's only 5'2", is tall for her country. There'd be a handful of people over in East Africa. They'd get in easy, right? Have you seen those folks? That tribe there in East Africa, and they got these really long legs. Some of them so tall, they just stand on the ground, they can dunk a basketball. They don't even have to leave their toes. They get pretty good there. Manute Bol was from over there. You got these Maasai people, they're just long and lanky, and they run fast, they jump high, and you say, hey, that's great. But the 10-foot basketball goal isn't God's standard. God's standard is way up at 20 feet. And now all of a sudden, you've got some of those little watermelons, and they're running, and they jump, and it's just funny to look at them, because they're not even going to get close. But even some of those people who are tall and stretched and they have amazing hops, if they are able to run with all their might and jump, they would still only get 13, 14 feet. They would still fall way short of the glory of God. But then a champion comes. A champion enters into this world, and this one man is able to drive to the goal and jump and with one hand slam that basket. That one man was Jesus. He alone hit the mark. That's a question. If you have two teams and both teams are at zero, it's a tie. Until that champion gets on the court and he's on one team, when he slams that basketball goal, if you're on his team, it only takes one point, doesn't it? Or one basket to win. And Jesus won. Question is, are you on his team? Elaimus, the sorcerer. The Bible says here in verse number 8, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. He was doing everything he could to stop the gospel and to tell the deputy that he didn't need Jesus. There were other ways. There were rituals. There was religiousness. There was drugs. There was all these other ways. But Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. In John chapter number 10, Jesus says, I am the door, I am the gate. If you go through me, you're going to find what you're looking for. He says, but those that try to get up some other way, those that try to sneak in some other way, what is it? They're a thief and a robber. For the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and destroy, but I have come that they might have life. And they might have it more abundantly. There are many voices in this world that will try to draw you away, distract you, that will tell you any number of things that will give you some comfort or designed to give you solace that you can get into heaven some other way but Jesus. But Jesus is the scariest to a sinner, isn't it? Going through Christ, you'll find, it seems to be the last option for someone who is a sinner. If there is some other way, you might look this way, you might look that way. Perhaps I can attach myself to some other way to heaven and feel good about it. People do. Isn't it funny that Jesus, when you look at him, is the only option? That's the one that people often don't want to. Your spirit wants to resist that. Something to be afraid of if you're in your sin. You're afraid of what you might have to give up. You're afraid of what the new life might be like. You often have no image. You have no idea of what the Christian life could be like and what God would expect from us. You think, oh, does that mean I have to give up everything I love? I guess in a way it does. What you don't understand is that everything that you should have will be given back to you. Most people don't know that. Verse number 9, the Bible says, then Saul, who is also called Paul, just so you know, The Bible's making his name change here, but it's not at his conversion. Saul is his Hebrew name. Paul is his Greek name. It's kind of like when you have a name that's way out of bounds. It's unfamiliar to the American public. And you move it into America, maybe somebody can't pronounce your name. And you change it. You give it American names. Both your names. You take a moniker. I know my wife, she's Paola in the Spanish world, and she's Paula in English, right? Setito? Seth? My poor daughter, she doesn't have a Spanish name. But there's Samuel. Samuel, that's pretty close, right? Daniel? Those are easy. But what if you got a name like Shu or Hung or Fang? We knew a young lady, her name was Hung. Such a pretty young lady, such an ugly name. She changed her name. What was her name now? Shayla. She decided her English name would be Shayla. She liked that much better. That's a big step up. Saul is now called Paul. Paul, of course, means little. He's going to see himself as a small man serving a big God. But look at verse number 9. How was he able to be effective? What truly made him effective in his witness, in this confrontation, this battle of wit, so to speak, this battle of spirituality? The Bible says, Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost. Notice that little clause, filled with the Holy Ghost. That's what would make what came next possible. If you're going to be a good witness in this world, you're going to end up facing a lot of challenges. You're going to face some cantankerous, difficult people. You're going to face angry, bitter people. In this day and age, look at the ugliness and the bitterness and the anti-Semitism you see out on the college campuses and you're seeing in the public. There's this irrational hatred for Jews. And I was speaking to our Jewish lawyer yesterday and sharing a little with him. I says, listen, I said, what the Jewish folks are starting to see out of these American campuses right now, says, we Christians, we've been facing this for decades. This vitriol that you're experiencing, this is how they feel about us as well. They felt about us like this for a long time. It's irrational. But there's a propaganda out there. There's a hatred out there being propagated in our public schools and in our colleges that are just filling the young people with a worldview that is decidedly, aggressively and purposely anti-Christian and consequently anti-Jewish. Judeo-Christian, in a lot of ways, is becoming an anathema. So every once in a while, you'll run into somebody that's uncomfortable. Daniel's out sharing the gospel yesterday, and somebody called the police on him, said, they're out here saying anti-Semitic things. Did you say anything anti-Semitic? Not a thing. So both he and James are both part Jewish. Part Jewish. They didn't say nothing anti-Semitic. They're just trying to call the police to get him in trouble. You say, why would somebody do something so evil, so vitriolic, when they know good and well that nothing anti-Jewish was being said, anti-Semitic was being said? They called, hoping to get him in trouble. You say, well, why would somebody do that? Because people are like that. And you say, people are evil? Oh, yeah. I remember about 10 years ago, 6 years ago, I was working on a Saturday overtime in a housing project, and it was about 11 o'clock in the morning, and they had built illegal rooms in this move-out, and the city was paying us to strip out all this illegal structure that had been built to create basically a flop house, a home where a whole bunch of drug addicts would stay and live in multiple rooms. And they had built these false walls up, and they were paying us to go in and tear these walls out, which meant some banging, right? So my partner and I, we got to the place to do the heavy, hard work a little bit later. We tried to do all the quieter work as early as we could. And my partner, about 11 o'clock, has to go back to the shop and get something. And I'm banging away, pulling stuff off. It's 11 o'clock in the morning. It's late in the morning. The police come knocking on the door, open the door. I'm standing there with a hammer, and the cops say, they're looking for somebody because one of the neighbors had called and said there was a white man with a knife running around the housing development threatening to kill people. And they were hoping that the cops would just come in and shoot me so they could keep sleeping off their drunk, because I was making too much noise on a Saturday morning. Somebody would treat my life so carelessly, a stranger who they didn't know, because they didn't want to hear some banging on the door because they stayed up drinking too late one night. My life was worth their sleep, just hoping they'd come in and shoot me. You say, could people do that? People evil like that? There's a lot of people out there who will do a lot of bad things, and you can't let that resistance stop you. You can't let that resistance stop you. The Holy Spirit filled the Apostle Paul. He was filled with the Holy Ghost, and he was ready for the proper confrontation, because God was going to do something. He set his eyes on him and said, "Oh, full of subtlety and all mischief." That word subtlety is the word guile. We had a wonderful Bible study Wednesday night at our prayer meeting. Encourage you to zoom in if you can't make it in person. But we had a really good Bible study when Jesus saw Nathanael coming. And he says, "Behold, an Israelite in whom there is no guile." There's no subtlety. There's no trickery. They don't have a two-faced agenda, a double agenda, right? There's no alternative motive. And here, the Apostle Paul says, you are full of a double agenda. Your heart is not right, it is not pure, you don't want what's best, you are hiding what you truly think and what you truly believe. He faces this man and calls him what he is. Thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? He said, wow, that's pretty strong language, isn't it? Yeah, that's pretty... This situation has obviously escalated to something ugly, hasn't it? But the sorcerer was trying to keep the deputy from Jesus. He had a hold on him, and he was trying to keep him from getting saved. And now God was going to do something, because Paul was bold and in the Spirit of God. He wasn't speaking in the flesh, though somebody might look at this and say, hey, Paul, this guy got you in the flesh. No, he was in the Spirit when he called him out. And there's a difference. Now, in order to understand what it means to be filled with the Spirit, you have to be an actual Christian. You've got to be a real Christian, meaning you have to be born again. Being born again isn't something that happens to you at your baptism, and a pastor, a priest, a rabbi, nobody can do hocus pocus over you, throw some water on you, nothing. They can't do that. That doesn't make you born again. The Bible says, repent and believe the gospel. It is a choice that you make when you, by faith, take a step of faith and believe from your heart, have that heart to heart with God, and you repent of your sins and trust in Christ. And it'll happen. See, when Jesus spoke that, he spoke it to a whole bunch of Jews being represented by Nicodemus in John chapter number 3. And Nicodemus was a leader of the Jews. He was a Pharisee. He's somebody who participated in all the rituals. He'd been circumcised. In some, like Catholicism, Orthodox, Presbyterians, they have baby baptism as a symbol of being put into the faith like the circumcision did for the Jews. Well, these guys had that. They had all the washings. They had all the proper education. They were raised in a religious family, and Jesus was confronting this full-grown man who was religious and religiously trained, had followed all the rituals, and was obedient as he could be to the Torah, to the legal do's and don'ts of his religion. And Jesus looked him straight in the face and said, you all must be born again. So Nicodemus, you're representing the Pharisees here. But let me tell you, Nicodemus, you and all that you represent, you must be born again. Jesus said that. Born again isn't this charismatic thing that you see on TV. It's a spiritual rebirth. Jesus clarifies it and says it's a spiritual rebirth. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. Marvel not that I say unto ye, ye must be born again. And then he continues in the passage and says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, right? So must the Son of Man be lifted up, because God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, is believing into him, should not perish but have everlasting life. He makes it pretty clear that in our sinful state, in our unforgiven state, we are not born again, but when we are born again, something happens. See, the serpent in the wilderness that was lifted up, the people looked to it in faith, and that which bit them in this world healed them by faith. So God so loved the world, and he's provided a great salvation. No, this man was blind, though he had thought he was seeing. He thought he was clever, he was highly educated, he was mastered in his arts, but his heart was not right with God. And the Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, called him out in public. And when he called him out in public, God had him move just a little further, and he accompanied it with a miracle. And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Now, what I want you to notice here is that God is gracious. So how can you say God's gracious when you see this? Well, this man had forced his hand, and it brought the challenge to a breaking point, to a moment, to a singularity in this conversation. And here this sorcerer, who had appeared to display himself to all these people as being a powerful wizard, even to the deputy, who was a man of a true political power, here he was, he could not save himself from the words of this Christian disciple. Paul didn't take a bat and hit him. He didn't go blind because he got hit in the side of the head with a bat, right? He didn't go blind because even a chunk of wall might have fallen from the ceiling and whacked him in the head. Paul, in his words, blindness had come upon you for a season, and the mist descended over him. See, here was a man who says he was a great seer of spiritual things, and now he was blind, because that was the truth about him, is that he was not a great seer. He was a great charlatan, and he was blind. That God loved him so much, too, that God didn't execute him. God didn't take him out. God gave him a second chance. For a season, he couldn't see at all, and this was an opportunity for him to experience what he really was. And the Apostle Paul, fascinatingly enough, experienced something very similar. And we don't know how it panned out in Elymas's life, but we do know what happened to Saul, who was called Paul, because Paul was humble before God when he saw Jesus and was blinded. And it gave him a chance to see that he thought he was so right about so many things. But here God was trumping him and said, no, you're wrong. You're blind. When Paul really came to his senses and realized, yeah, you know what? Everything I believed wasn't right. The things that I had internalized and accepted and defended with such vigor, I was wrong. And it wasn't until he was broken and humbled himself before the Lord Jesus Christ, and he had that real heart-to-heart with God, that's when Jesus sent the disciple in to lay hands on him and said, Paul, receive thy sight. See, Paul's physical sight returned when he gained spiritual sight inside. Now that he was seeing from the heart, God gave him back his physical eyes. And those eyes would never be blinded again. So the next several decades of his life, he would preach with zeal and unbelievable conviction the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think of my father-in-law. I thought about him this morning, I meditated upon this message, and I thought about my father-in-law. My wife had the wonderful song last night. In fact, thought about it a little bit last night. My son turned 14 yesterday. Lenora turns, well, she's got her birthday today. She's in her 90s, and God bless her, Connie's mom. Grandpa George, he's singing, and God bless you. He's a pastor now, and think of what God's done in his life over the last many years. My wife and I have been married 26 years. He was called to start a church at 50 years of age. He's in his 70s now. And I remember talking to him about his life and about his testimony a decade ago, and I said, George, how'd you get saved? He says, you know, I was an atheist. I didn't believe. I was angry at God. I was angry at the world. I was just an angry person. He said, I was an atheist. How long was he an atheist? He was an atheist for 30 years. He had his education. He had been to college. He had been popular in his country. He had been famous. He was a very handsome guy, I can say. Helped to produce some good-looking daughters, the one that I got. Some pretty good-looking grandchildren. He had fame. He had good looks. He had a beautiful young wife at the time. He came from a prominent family in his country. His grandfather wrote the national anthem for Guatemala. He's descended from conquistadors. He has a very proud heritage of presidents and powerful men in his family. He was very proud. And he was angry. He says, I was an atheist for 30 years, but then God. But then God allowed some pain to come in his life that he could not handle. And the faithfulness of his wife praying for him for a very long time moved in his life and broke his will. And there, sitting in a tub one night, in pain, being told by the doctor now almost 40 years ago, wow, over 40 years ago now, the doctor told him that he was going to die from his disease. And there was nothing they could do for him anymore. 40 years ago, he sat in that tub, and the pastor of his wife's church came over and spent 3 hours with him, sat on the toilet with his Bible and talked to him about God and life and Jesus and salvation. And after 3 hours sitting in that tub soaking in his pain, he was broken before God and he surrendered his life to Jesus Christ. And God opened his eyes spiritually and God healed him. A man that was supposed to die 40 years ago was healed by God. And he said, God, you heal me, I will serve you for the rest of my life. God kept his word, and George has kept his, has served the Lord Jesus Christ with all of his heart and soul and mind. And by the time I met him, he was one of the most godly and still one of the most godly men I've ever met or known in my life. And you would have never thought that this was the same man from 40 years ago. Because that's what happens when you get born again. You have to be broken before God, and he will heal you. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, the deputy believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. You'll find that God often does things, even allows bad things to happen in certain situations, especially when Christians are involved, so that others can believe.